on the Blockbuster Busters Halloween Havoc.
Now, if you excuse me, on behalf of vampires and werewolves everywhere, I have some sparkly pricks to pummel. A little bit heavier than usual.
Not so fast, ERod. I have a movie for you to review before you bust that one.
Oh no, Crypty. You can't spring another Twilight movie on me. The other two haven't even been released to theaters yet.
Oh no, I'm not gonna make you review another Twilight movie. I'm gonna make you review a Twilight clone.
Damn you! You maniac!
In a world of uncertainty, where movie theaters are plagued by remakes and sequels. In a world where big budget movies can still suck. In this world, we have the Blockbuster Buster.
Werewolves and witches, I'm ERod and I'm the Blockbuster Buster. As if the Twilight craze wasn't bad enough, it has inadvertently given birth to another equally horrible trend, the Twilight clones! This new horrid genre of movie has been dubbed by a few of my fellow reviewers as tween porn, and I have to agree. Cause these movies are nothing but shallow, pretentious, superficial crap meant to prey on the romantic misconceptions of young girls. And more Twilight clones are on the way, so it doesn't seem like this trend is coming to an end anytime soon. Hell, the whole first half of the Amazing Spider-Man trailer bears a heavy resemblance to this genre. I hope to God that they're not actually dragging Spidey into this, and that they're only marketing the movie this way to attract the tween crap. And that the actual movie in no way resembles a Twilight clone. Heaven help us if they drag comic book movies into this bullshit! God knows they've tried! Today we dig into not just the most successful Twilight clone, but the most overt, as the studio went out of its way to recruit the original Twilight director, Catherine Hardwicke, to direct this movie. And they got Billy Burke, who plays the dad in the Twilight movies, to play the dad in this movie as well. Hell, rumor has it that they wanted to cast Taylor Lautner in this movie as the love interest slash werewolf suspect. Subtle! Before I jump into this, I want to make it explicitly clear that I am a firm supporter of the mixing of the genres, and that I'm well aware that horror fairy tales are nothing new. Hell, most fairy tales started out as horror stories. But when they mix horror, fairy tales, and tween porn together, that's where I draw the line! So our movie begins with a completely unnecessary Stephen Sommers brand flashback, in which we see the young Red Riding Hood hanging out with the town bad boy, who's always decked out in black.
Subtle!
So Red and Peter play in the woods.
Wait a minute!
Peter? Like Peter and the Wolf?
Subtle!
I'm sorry, I keep going off on this movie and technically nothing has happened yet. Let's enjoy watching a couple of cute little kids peacefully playing in the woods.
Kill the weapon! Kill the weapon!
So we cut to 10 years later where we meet the grown-up Red Riding Hood and Amanda Siegfried? Oh, sweetie, I love and respect you enough to forgive you for Jennifer's body, but this? Thus, we are introduced to the village of Daggerhorn, where everything, including the elderly, look fabulous! And in spite of the movie taking place in the 1300s, this town is so advanced they have both hair gel and Botox injections. So apparently, Daggerhorn has been haunted by werewolves for over two generations. And the citizens are completely used to getting attacked by werewolves. Red finds out that her parents have arranged for her to marry Henry, the extremely nice, handsome, rich guy. This, of course, does not sit well with Red, as she wants to marry the poor, mysterious man in black with plenty of product in his hair. Why are tweens so infatuated with hair gel? What? Sadly, before Red has a chance to run away with Peter, her sister is found dead. Oh my God! Does anybody have any theories as to what could have killed this girl?
Well, this is not a boat accident. It wasn't any propeller. It wasn't any coral reef. And it wasn't Jack the Ripper.
You know, it was probably the rabbit seeking revenge.
You killed my father. Prepare to die.
Jesus Christ! The men of Daggerhorn seek revenge, so they form a mob and attack the werewolf's lair, and... What? What? Where? Wait, what's going on? They killed the werewolf. I guess. Oh well, that wasn't so bad. So Red goes to see her incredibly well-preserved grandmother.
Good morning, dear.
Grandma gives Red the infamous Red Hood and sends her back to town just in time for the professional werewolf hunter to arrive, played by Gary Oldman. Oh, and we know he's a professional werewolf hunter because a town fanboy told us so.
Oh god, he looks exactly like the picture in his trading card. Did you know that he slayed 11 werewolves with his 12th level silver sword? Oh god, I just want to touch it.
No.
So the prestigious Father Solomon addresses the crowd and wait a minute. Father Solomon? Like Solomon Kane? The first monster hunter slash paranormal investigator? Created by Robert E. Howard? Nope, sorry, I'm not referring to this fanatical weirdo by that name. From now on, you're Cardinal Creepy. So Cardinal Creepy goes on to explain that what they killed was not a werewolf. Cause when you kill a werewolf, the creature reverts to his human form. Case in point, a werewolf paw that he cut off, which reverted back into a human hand, which he carries around in a handy dandy wooden box just for the purposes of this demo. However, Colonel Ty over here disagrees and says that they should party like it's 1399. Alright, a good old fashioned medieval party! With a lady that has a bush for a head? What? And reenactments of the Three Little Pigs?
Oh, a girl with breasts and everything!
Oh, come on, guys, you can do better than that! I guess it's up to me. Okay, let's see if I can get this party started. I haven't done any medieval dancing in a while. Okay, first, you bow. And, then you go like this. And like this.
Why don't you show us all a dance of your country?
Fine.
Taking you nowhere.
Angel.
Look at that sky, life's begun. Nights are warm and the days are young.
Yeah, now you're getting into it. Whoa, check it out, check it out.
There's my feet, they lost the
girls on wild Puritan style.
And you save our little souls.
Ladies.
Damn, Toaster's taking over Galactica.
Whoa! Werewolf attack! Quickly, somebody draw a picture of the werewolf! Ugh, never mind. Wow, that was pretty intense, even with the shitty CG werewolf. Now, I should note that before the werewolf fled the scene, he did give Red a very important message.
Oh my god, you can speak.
After the attack, Cardinal Creepy assesses the damages. Hey everybody, look! One of the knights survived! Oh!
A man bitten is a man cursed!
Ah, that was so harsh! So everybody that's bitten by a werewolf is automatically killed? Did anybody even consider looking for a cure for lycanthropy?
No.
Since the so-called monster expert has no leads on the werewolf's true identity, he starts accusing people all willy-nilly, not just of being the werewolf, but of being witches. Wait, what? WTF, mofo, what the hell do witches have to do with werewolves? Ah, fuck it. Soon enough, he ends up accusing an innocent, mentally challenged boy, simply because he did a card trick for him, and he puts the boy in an iron elephant.
Excellent!
Guys, it's a torture device.
Bogus.
The mentally challenged boy's sister pleads for his life, and even reveals to Cardinal Creepy that she saw Red talking to the wolf, which leads Creepy to believe that Red and the wolf are in league with one another, and then proceeds to arrest her. Okay, but I still have one question. How come Cardinal Creepy has silver nails?
To kill a werewolf.
Ah! You creepy bastard!